Welcome back to Badass Women 50 Plus. I am Robin Lane, producer, director, and psychotherapist. Today we will have many ages represented, from a 24-year-old to my august age of 86. 86.
86.
And our co-host will once again be the beautiful young actress and filmmaker Maria Sakor, who, as I have said, is a challenge for me because she is so much prettier than me. But I like to tell myself that she's only prettier because she's so much younger, but actually, she's prettier. At any rate, today's program will focus on the very complex subject of love and in its many variations. Now remember, we also like to fool around, so sometimes after a very serious moment, or even before a very serious moment, you will see a wackadoodle image.
Hi, I am Maria Sakor, and Robin, do go on, because flattery will get you everywhere. Although I'm far from 50, Robin is 86 and going on timeless wit and gorgeousness, and who knows what else. When you're like her, it's apparent that she knows the secret to living your best life, or she has 9 lives. She's quite an expert on love, but what do you expect from someone who's lived so long? And love is today's theme. The Greeks had all kinds of names for the different kinds of love. Anyhow, I'm gonna let Robin go into it with you, as she just loves to show off how smart she is.
Of course I know everything. I'm not only old, I'm Jewish. Now let's talk about erotic love, or eros as the Greeks called it. Romantic love in Greek myth is a form of madness brought about by being struck by one of Cupid's arrows. We fall in love, which is not always so cool. For instance, in Greek legend, one great love affair led to a 10-year war and the downfall of the country. And while it's true that romantic love can lead to all kinds of problems, it can also lead to great happiness, and so we pine for it. Today, we and our guests will run the gamut from agape love, which is love of community, to storge love, which is the love of a mother for a child, a daughter for her father. Then the great Judy Scott will take us out with a love song that just about sums it all up. And let's begin with my love story. It was April 1981, and I was planning an event in my home for Princess Irene of the Netherlands when I was invited to a fundraiser. I went figuring it would be excellent for networking, and that's what I'm doing when a guy starts talking to me in a personal way, telling me the story of his life, and then he asks for my number. And to get rid of him, I give it. He calls next morning, and I figured, why not? I have to meet the princess's emissary anyway at 6 o'clock, and let him meet me at 7:30, and he can buy me dinner. Well, that happens, and as soon as I see him, I go, oh my God, this is going to be a short evening. One drink, and I will be gone. So as we make our way to his car, my heel gets caught on the cobblestone street, and I grab his arm to, you know, for some kind of balance, and as soon as I touch it, I go, nice bicep. That's a surprise, but well, never mind. I had just been with all these elegant Europeans, and next to them, this guy seems like a turkey. So we get in his car, and he's talking, and here's what happened. We are on the uptown side of 34th Street and 7th Avenue, and the car stops for a red light, and suddenly, I start to listen, and I think, wow, he's really smart. And then he makes me laugh, and I realize that he's a lot sharper than those Europeans by far. Takes my hand, and an electric current shoots through me. The light changes, and within the 3 seconds that it takes to get to the downtown side of the street, the arrow has struck. I have fallen in love, and with a married man, a suburbanite, a guy with 2 kids, and ill-fitting suits. Harvey Krauss and me, we had absolutely nothing in common. But if you asked him, he'd always say that he was in love with me long before we met. He passed away in April, but in March, when the shutdown came, and he had already been ill for several years, and his hands would shake. And we would sit together, and I would try to hold his hand, but it would tremble so badly, I would say, "Keep your darn hand still," but he couldn't. So I'd hold him by his wrist, and my body would be flooded with a feeling of absolute contentment. Go figure. It turned out to be the real deal. Here, take a look.
Come fly with me, let's fly away. If you can use some exotic booze, there's a bar in far Bombay. Come fly with me, let's fly away. Come fly with me, let's float down to Peru. In Llama Land, there's a one-man band, and he'll toot his flute for you. Come fly with me, let's take off in the blue. Once I get you up there, where the air is rarefied, we'll just fly starry-eyed. Once I get you up there, I'll be holding you.
My father was educated by the Jesuits and had a heart of gold. He set an example that resonated in my heart throughout my life. When I do anything for the greater good, not letting even my own doubts stand in the way of reaching out to those in need, I honor him. As such, I became an activist and developed a skill set which recently enabled me to enter into the world of politics. Oftentimes, people confuse activism with anger and rage, but I can tell you my social justice is grounded on the foundation of Dad's teachings. The Greeks called it agape, love committed to the well-being of others. It was March 2020 and COVID-19 had begun. Many, myself included, were on the verge of panic. Any ailment we had felt like we had COVID, and simple things seemed overwhelming. People were sick and some were dying. Incomes were threatened. For the first time in my life, I felt frightened. And although all I wanted to do was hide under the covers, I knew I had to help. I became obsessed with seeing how I could make a difference. I joined a local Democratic committee. I was concerned about the needs in my community. And though venturing out in public was scary, I could hear my father's voice urging me on to defend those in need. Then the primary elections occurred. The Dems had a chance. One of the candidates resigned. There was a seat for an open committee member, and I was now being considered. A pandemic, the BLM movement on the rise, our country in a disarray and an empty seat on a committee? Who in the world would take this on? The country was horribly divided, each party highlighting all that was wrong with the other. So running in a largely red town, not only was I hit with hate, sarcasm, insults, and a blackmail attempt to have me resign, but I was treated as the enemy. I had to constantly remind myself that I wasn't doing this for myself, but for my community. My focus stayed with the people who needed my skill sets. The end result? I did not win. However, there are many who know that they can now depend on me for anything, because whether elected or not, my devotion to them and ability to serve supersedes any titles or positions. Agape love is not always recognized. It can be a thankless and lonely path. The reward lies solely in doing the task. I have to remind myself when the chips are down to look in the mirror and say to myself, girl, put on some lipstick and get it together. For every sacrifice you all make, I wish you agape.
Agape love, Maria? Love thy neighbor as thyself? Well, our new president, Joe Biden, is certainly calling for that. And if he can help heal the divide that now exists between Americans, if he can make that happen, then he will be the new Moses. But hey, I'm not a cynic. I'm all for giving love a chance. And here's Natalie Rogers to talk about Storge love, also known as mother love.
When Harold proposed, the deal was sealed upon my understanding and consent that we were entering a childless marriage. No baby. Me, free spirit, I'm mad about Harold. I found it really easy to say, okay. But 2 years into my marriage, I wasn't prepared when Harold turned to me and said, would you like to have a baby? A baby? I was 40 years old. We had no money. A baby? I was scared. But Harold would have none of it. And so, I reluctantly agreed. In 3 months, there was a baby bump, altering my perfect body. As my belly got bigger and bigger, a kind of love descended upon me that left flowers at the doorstep of my mind. Before we knew it, there I was in the delivery room after 24 hours of horrendous labor, huffing and puffing, trying to push that baby out into the fresh air. At last, the star attraction arrived. A teensy, eensy, weensy little bitty infant, 7 pounds, was born in July of 1974. Me, who had never in her life babysat or even held a baby in her arms, was transported to a new identity. Mom. I was 41 years old, giving birth to a perfectly healthy baby girl and with no insurance. Who does that in the 70s? I had traveled the earth as an entertainer and now found my maternal identity. No lover, but I've had a few, has ever received the adoration I lavished upon this tiny creature. How my heart beat wildly when they wheeled her into my room for nursing. I got so excited, I almost jumped out of my skin. We couldn't believe that she was ours, that we could take her with us, that we wouldn't have to return her like a library book. We named her Colette and took her home. I couldn't bear to be apart from her, and so I took her wherever I went. When I was with Colette, there was a perpetual smile on my lips. The romance of loving my daughter has been the happiest and most satisfying experience of my life. She has developed into an independent professional, a happy wife, a super mom, and given me the opportunity to relive my baby days with my two adorable grandchildren, Leo and Ben. When I was a young woman, a romantic young woman, I used to think I knew all about love. But mother love is on a landscape all its own, one I am blessed to inhabit.
Storge, family love. Women's hormones surge as their bodies undergo the physical transformation needed to create another life. Neuroscience now reveals that women also undergo brain remodeling, actually a reduction in gray matter that can persist for at least 2 years. This loss, however, can be seen as a good thing because the more brain changes a mother experienced, the higher she scored on measures of emotional attachment. Motherhood demands new ways of tuning in. And as Natalie put it, having an infant no bigger than a kitten dependent on you means finding new behaviors. And so for a time, the brain adapts to fulfill that function.
From Connecticut is Valerie Lynn.
Since I was 9 years old, I knew I was a femme fatale. I had gotten hold of the then racy paperback, Messalina Valeria, Conqueror of the Roman Empire, and I knew I was her. At 10, my destiny was sealed. Barbie doll was born. I thought my heart had stopped beating. She was sexy, bosomy, blonde, and had the most fabulous wardrobe and accessories. I made it my life's mission to emulate Barbie and find myself the perfect Ken. And that's just what I did. It may have taken 2 marriages and 50 plus years, but I did it. I married my dream man. From the get-go, I loved boys and they loved me. But I was always able to categorize the love of my life versus this is no longer right for me and done. My first marriage to a literal Ken was when I was 20. We had a beautiful son, but then due to a host of issues, I realized that though I was only 25 with a young child, this husband was no longer right for me and done. During the next 10 years, providing for my son and myself resulted in so much business travel that I had to put the babysitter on retainer. Everywhere I went, I met men. I always was a man magnet, but my philosophy has been either I'm married or I'm single. I don't play house. I met my second husband in the late 80s. And for over 20 years, we had a truly wonderful marriage. We traveled the world. I devoted myself to him, and we had a great life. Then he wanted to be an old man and retire from the world, which also meant me. And from out of nowhere, I was faced with a divorce and the world of corrupt lawyers. Here's where my skill set served me well. I know how to master the moment. Regardless of the challenge, I face it head on. No lawyer got the best of me. Like Messalina Valeria, I could compartmentalize my dating life by being both sensuous and charming, yet, whenever necessary, be the ruthless, unstoppable woman that rounds out my personality. I've always believed that though love can find you anywhere, I don't sit around waiting for it. I believe in dating sites, pursuing many interests, leading to meeting other people and introductions, doing the hard work it takes to stay glamorous, and never allowing myself to indulge in negativity has worked for me. Then serendipity stepped in. And that brings me to the question that everyone who knows I was in my 60s when I met my beloved asked, how did I meet him? A friend and I put together the idea of a LinkedIn-style event. But rather than online, we do it face-to-face. I found myself combing my lists of high school friends from past class reunions and summer camp. As fate would have it, a camp friend happened to be in Paris with her brother. That's when my Evite arrived on her laptop. There was my photo, her brother, Ken. had been single for the past 2 years. She asked, would you like to meet Val, and showed him my picture. She wrote back to me saying she remembered that I was in the middle of an ugly divorce and her very nice brother, who was a retired attorney, lives near me. He would like to meet me. Would I like to meet him? Absolutely. Kent contacted me from Paris. I guess he liked the picture. We made a date. Ironically, it was the same date that I had achieved an unbelievable legal settlement from my past attorney. Remember, I told you, no corrupt lawyer would get the best of me. Between my pro se legal prowess, my feminine charms and my ability to remember every hilarious episode of Seinfeld word for word, our destiny was sealed. And here's my best advice for women looking for that special man. Look everywhere, but don't forget to look back. Regardless of your age, childhood connections run deep. Although ours was a first date, having his sister's stamp of approval gave us the ability to cut to the chase. Our marriage is full of adventures and quiet pleasures. I feel blessed and have never been happier. I wish you all the same.
The Greeks called it philosia, self-love. To care for others, we must first care for ourselves. Valerie is a designer. Back when she was going through her divorce, she visited. I came down in the morning and spread out were law books. I said, "What do you know about the law?" She said, "What I don't know, I will learn." You want to know how to get that way? Keep pushing your boundaries every day, slowly but consistently in the right direction. If you start to grow these habits of self-love, you will come out a winner.
From Monticello, Georgia, is Nikes Musso.
My dad's birthday's coming up, and it's hard. So I wrote him a letter, so here it is. Dear friends, I miss you. I think of you quite often. Who would have thought that I'd be recording this video? Who would have thought that your death would have hurt me the way that it does? Your birthday is a few days away, and I just want you to know that I am happy. I know you used to worry about me, worry if I'd ever be okay in life, if I'd be in good hands, if someone would love me as much as you did, so you can breathe a little. Sorry. I'm great. You'd be glad to know. Child, I didn't think it'll hit me like this. Hold on. Get it together, girl. Get it together. Oh, man. You'd be glad to know that Joseph reminds me so much of you. He's a hard worker. There's not anything he can't do, but most importantly, he loves me. I'm happy you got to meet him. But thank you for just being you. Thank you for waiting for mommy to fall in love with her. Thank you for wanting a girl. Thank you for naming me. Thank you for my first bike, my first skates, my dogs, my car, and everything in between. I wished we talked more, laughed more, but that wasn't God's plan. You taught me how to be selfless, kind, to be independent, maybe a little too independent because your girl struggles sometimes asking for help. You taught me to be observant and resilient. Sometimes I dream of you being at my wedding, giving me away, of you being a grandfather, but they are just dreams. I want you to know that although it's been 7 months, time does not always heal all wounds. Friends, I'm trying my best to accept your death, to grieve you properly. My birthday is 6 days after yours, and I'm dreading not being able to hear your voice. Ooh, child, I cannot. I'm dreading not being able to hear your voice, but I will always hold your last words near to my heart. That you always loved me, that I was the best thing to ever happen to you, and to keep following Jesus. Happy birthday, friends. I love you.
Whatever point in time one loses a parent, no matter your age and no matter theirs, it is never the right time because there is never enough time. But amidst the heartbreak, there is the luck of having loved, of having been loved, and the blessing of that shared experience. So while love can be pure and sweet, it can be painful and dreadful. And if I ask 10 different people to define love, I will probably get 10 different answers. Maria and I and our guests, we've all been very lucky, be they husbands and daughters, father, community. We've all been enriched by these attachments, which, as humans, we are hardwired to form. But regardless of how one defines love, all badass women are sure of these two things: that love cannot flourish without intense commitment, and that intense commitment must be a two-way street. So before Judy Scott sings us out with one of the greatest of love songs, remember, we are on 7:30, the last Tuesday of every month. And don't forget to follow us on Instagram and YouTube.
Here's one badass who knows how to love, signing off to another.
Take it away, Judy Scott.